Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Tathai Vasatya Ki Parthai Pujitas Chabibanditaha Nisha Sada Sanenyecha Pujita Paryupasata Tathaiva Satyaki Parthai Pujitas Chabibanditaha Nishashata Sanenyecha Pujita Paryupasata Tathaiva Satyaki Parthai Pujitas Chabibanditaha Nishasada Sanenyecha Pujita Paryupasata Similarly, Satyaki, Satyaki, Parathai, by the sons of Prita, Pujita, worshipped, Cha, and Abhivandita, welcomed, Nishashada, sat down. Asane, on a seat. Anye, the others. Cha, also. Pujita, worshipped. Paryupasita, sat around. Satyaki also accepted a seat of honor after receiving worship and welcome from the Pandavas, and the Lord's other companions, being duly honored, sat down in various places. Kritam samagatya krita bivadanas tayati hardadra drishabhirambita apristavamstam kushalam sahasnasham pitrisvasaram paripristha bandava. The Lord then went to see his aunt, Queen Kunti. He bowed down to her, and she embraced him, her eyes moist with great affection. Lord Krishna inquired from her and her daughter-in-law, Draupadi, about their welfare, and they in turn questioned him at length about his relatives in Dwarka. Purport. Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur envisions that as Lord Krishna was sitting on his seat, he saw his aunt Kunti approaching in great eagerness to see him. He then rose at once, quickly went up to her and offered his obeisances. Her eyes moistened with extreme love. She embraced him and smelled his head. Om Agyanti Mirandasya Yananjana Chalakaya Chakshuru Nilidam Jena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Sri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Tadati Swapadantikam Bandeham Sri Guru Sri Jutha Padakamalam Sri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Sri Rupam Sagrajataham Sahakana Raghunathan Pitham Tham Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padam Sahakana Lalita Sri Vishakam Bithamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostate Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vansha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patithanam Bhavanibhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasati Gaura Bhakta Brinda
Thank you.
We are reading today from the Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, Chapter 58, entitled Krishna Marries Five Princesses, Texts 6 and 7. The Pandavas who were great devotees of Krishna, the eldest brother Yudhisthira was truly a well-wisher for everyone. But yet so many injustices were committed to them. This is explained in great detail in Mahabharata. Kunti was the sister of Vasudev, who became the father of Krishna and Balaram. Surasena, their father, promised Kunti Bhoja, who was his relative and who had no children, that if he ever had a daughter, he would place her under his care. Vasudev's sister, whose name was Prita, was thereby given to the care of Kunti Bhoja. And thus she was called by the name Kunti. And we know the story, how she was so beautiful in her character, in her actions, in her words, in her physical appearance, in every way. Durvasa Muni came to visit King Kunti Bhoja. And as we were speaking last night, Durvasa Muni, son of Anasuya and Atri Muni, was an expansion of Rudra, and he was easily pleased and easily angered. When he was angry, it was devastating. And when he was pleased, it was very nice. So generally, when he came to a place, it was a very fearful situation. It's like when an important guest comes, there's usually some fear. You don't want to displease him. But when it's Durvas Muni, it's a very serious subject matter. So Kunti Bhoja had his lovely daughter Kunti take care of him. And by her graciousness, her kindness, and her absolute genuineness, she just had nothing but good inside and out. Sometimes great sages like Durvasa, if they detect any anartha or unwanted quality in you, they know exactly how to make it explode. But Kunti had no qualities except her goodness. So she served him so pleasingly, with so much effort and care, that he gave her this benediction, a mantra where she could call any demigod, any of the devas. She just meditates, chants the mantra, they will immediately appear. She was just a young girl, very small. After Durvas Muni left with this blessing, she was just curious, because a young girl being given a mantra like this, naturally you want to try it. So one morning she saw the sun rising, such a beautiful sunrise. And she meditated on Surya and chanted the mantra, and Surya came. And she didn't know what to do, actually, because Surya is a very powerful deva, and she's a little girl. So she served him nicely and offered prayers to him. And he said, if I come, I must give you a child. That is my rule. But she said, how can you give me child? I'm just a little girl. He said, by my deva-like powers, you will remain a virgin. And then a child was put in her womb and was born really quickly, because devas don't have to go through all these months of labor and like earthly people. And the child was born from her ear. And therefore he was given the name Karna. But she didn't know how to explain this to her relatives. Now think of yourself being a little girl, and all of a sudden there's this little baby who has golden earrings and a chest plate. So she was confused. She made a little basket and very lovingly put the baby in the basket and prayed to Surya, please protect your child. And then she put him in Ganga and he flowed away. And a charioteer named Adiratha discovered. Little baby floating in a river. And he and his wife Radha were childless. So they've considered this to be a great blessing. And they loved this child as their own child and raised him with such affection. Meanwhile, later on, the great King Pandu, born of Vyasadeva, his two brothers, Dhritarashtra and Vidura. But of the three, Pandu was the most heroic and powerful. Vidura was the most saintly, but he was disqualified from the throne. Dhritarashtra was the eldest, but because he was blind, he was not qualified. Meanwhile, Pandu was so powerful that he literally took his armies and conquered the entire earth. But he was fair. He was a man of dharma. He didn't exploit. He didn't unnecessarily plunder. He actually brought real justice in places where there was so much injustice. And he came to the Swayamvara, and there Kunti gave her heart to him. They were married. He also married another named Madri. You know the story. But somehow or other, Pandu made a serious mistake. After he conquered the world, he went with his two wives into the forest just to live peacefully. And somehow or other, the way this world works is whoever we are, we sometimes make mistakes. And sometimes those mistakes can create such reversals. So he was cursed that if he ever touches a woman, he would die. So they wanted children. And Kunti Devi explained the blessing she had. Now it can actually be used for a really good purpose. And Pandu said, call Yamaraj. Dharmaraj, he's the most pure, sinless Mahajan
the upholder of the highest religious principles. And from Yamaraj, Yudhisthira was born. Most powerful of the devas is Vayu, the lord of the wind. So on Pandu's recommendation, Kunti called Vayu and Bhima was born. And from Indra, Arjuna. Kunti gave the mantra to Madri and she meditated on the Aswini Kumars, two brothers, and from them, Nakula Sahadev. Then Pandu made another mistake and he died. This is Mahabharata. So, Kunti now, Madri went with her husband Pandu. Kunti wanted to, but the rishis and sages in the forest told her that somebody has to take care of these five children. So she brought them back to Hastinapur. But during that time, Duryodhana, the son of Dhritarashtra, was the center of everyone's attention. Gandhari was pregnant. Gandhari was the wife of Dhritarashtra. At the same time that Kunti. But what happened is Kunti gave birth to Yudhisthira first. And Gandhari later became disturbed. And out of anger, she hit her womb and a hard lump came out. And she didn't know what to do. She was about to throw it away. Then Vyasadev said, I already gave you a benediction, you will have 100 sons. So he made 100 pots and put some ghee in it. And then by his mystical powers, that lump divided into 100 parts and each one was put in a pot. And the firstborn was Duryodhana. And as soon as he was born, everything possible inauspicious started happening everywhere around. And this little child, a baby, you know, little babies, they cry, they go, Well, when Duryodhana was born, he didn't cry. He shrieked. It was horrible. It's like he was born, it was like, People's. It's like. This was evil. It was just total evil coming out of him. People were shocked. And all these terrible things were happening everywhere around. And Vidura and others told Dhritarashtra, you should get rid of this son. You already have 99 others, but get rid of this son. Because he's going to do nothing but cause horrible, horrible consequences to his life. But Duryodhana was attached. I mean, Dhritarashtra was attached to his firstborn. And soon, from the other pots, all these little children started getting born. And they were the 100 sons of Dhritarashtra. Now, while Pandava was in the forest, Pandu, with Kunti and his five children. They were there for many years. Pandu actually was very much loved by Dhritarashtra. Because after all, he's the one who created the Kuru kingdom in the way it was. And he entrusted it all to Dhritarashtra. Until his eldest son, Yudhisthira, was old enough to take the throne. So that was the agreement. Dhritarashtra would rule the kingdom until
the rightful king was of age. But while the Pandavas were gone, Duryodhana, he was so wicked, even as a little boy, and so envious. But at the same time, he was incredibly skillful. He had a brilliant intelligence. He was great at fighting with weapons. He was very, very managerially inclined. He could get almost anything done. So it was very impressive. And because he was like the eldest of the princes, in the absence of the Pandavas, he was getting so much attention. And in this world, it's human nature. The more we get, the more we become attached to what we have. Detachment is very simple. Prakrite kriyamana nigunai karmani sarvasha ahankara vimudhatma karatahamiti manyate. Detachment is to understand whatever I have is God's property. Whatever intelligence, whatever abilities, whatever influence I have over others, it's all given to me by the higher power of God's grace. Nothing is mine. Bhoktaram jagatapasam sarvaloka maheshwaram suhradam sarvabhutanam gyatvamam shantim richajati. Krishna tells in Gita what the acharyas declare to be the peace formula. Because people in this world want peace. There's so much war and so much conflict, so much unhealthy, destructive, envious competition in this world. And there's so many organizations and campaigns to bring about peace. And many of them are very helpful. But according to the Bhagavad Gita, they are only dealing with the symptoms of the problem. However much you treat symptoms, if the core disease is still present, then another symptom will come. And then another and another. And sometimes there are just so many symptoms you can't even deal with them anymore. So Krishna tells the peace formula. He goes right to the very core of the heart of the disease that disturbs people's peace. And he explains, one can attain true everlasting peace if they just live by three principles. That Bhagavan, Sri Krishna, is the proprietor of everything that exists. Sarva Loka Maheshwaram. Sarva Loka means every planet in every creation is the property of God. He's the creator, he's the maintainer, and ultimately he withdraws it according to his will. Nothing is mine. And ultimately the Lord is the supreme enjoyer of everything. Samsadhir Haritoshana. That means if everything is God's property, everything should be used in harmony with God's will. And Surada Sarvabhutana. And that one Supreme Lord, who is the father, the mother of every living being, is the most intimate, ever well-wishing, best friend of all beings. This is very important. We can be happy in any situation if we just have realization of this, that Krishna is our ever well-wishing friend, not only to us, but to everyone. Krishna loves everyone, infinitely, forever. He's not partial to anyone, but he reciprocates according to how we live. So Krishna, has revealed this secret to us. It's so simple. But Duryodhana, he was so much intoxicated and infatuated by the respect and the power he was getting, because he had no rival. His father was blind and old and disqualified in so many ways, and there he was, the next ruler. And among all the children, he was the greatest in everything. And after Pandu passed away, Kunti couldn't take care of those children in the forest anymore without her husband. So she brought them back to the kingdom. And Dhritarashtra, when he heard his brother Pandu had died, he was actually very grief-stricken. But now Yudhisthira, he was completely different than Duryodhana. He had brilliant intelligence. He was expert at everything he did, like Duryodhana, but he was humble and he was respectful to everyone and he was everyone's well-wisher and he was never thinking about himself. He was always thinking of everyone else. So everyone in Hastinapur fell in love with Yudhisthira. And Bhima, who was actually born the same day as Duryodhana, they were equals. Yudhisthira was older. Bhima was so strong. He used to play with the Kurus, and he would say, "All 100 of you, let's wrestle." And these Kurus, they were really arrogant little kids. You know, they were spoiled like anything. They were expecting to be the kings, the rulers, the everything. And Bhima would just throw them around like toys. And this really insulted them. Not only does everyone love Yudhisthira, but Bhima always defeats us. And Bhima, he would defeat them, and he had no animosity, he had no envy, he just, for him it was just play. He would just beat them up. That's what little Kshatriya kids do. But it was just play for him, there was no ill feelings. But for Duryodhana and his brothers, it was intolerable. Duryodhana completely was conquered by envy, because he wanted to be in the center. And for a while, he was in the center, and he was enjoying it. And now, someone else is coming that's taking his position. And not only that, but Yudhisthira was the rightful heir to the throne that Duryodhana craved to have. He couldn't tolerate being anyone's servant. He wanted to be the master, the controller, the enjoyer. Usually in this world, you're not envious of somebody who could do something that you don't know how to do. You're usually envious of somebody who does the same thing you do, but better. Yes? Just like, you know, if you're very proud of being a good dancer, and somebody else is a good scientist, you're not envious of that. You can tolerate them being a good scientist.
But if somebody dances better than you and gets louder applause and more people looking and affectionate, it's like fire going in your heart. Can't tolerate it.
And similarly, if you're a really good scientist and you're getting all kinds of grants and people are praising you and everything like that, you can easily tolerate a good dancer. But another scientist? That's human tendency. Where we're getting our enjoyment of certain types of adoration, distinction, profit, it's very, very difficult to tolerate somebody who's actually getting more attention and getting more profit and being more successful. I read a couple years ago, one musician, he got an award of the number one best song that he wrote and sang of all time for a particular form of music. And there were hundreds and thousands of songs by some of the greatest artists. But his was voted to be the number one song of all, the greatest song of all time. So he was interviewed. This is the most prestigious award a musician can get in one sense. He wrote and sung the greatest song of all time. They asked him, what is your feeling getting this award? He said, nothing. Because in a couple years, some other song will be voted better than mine. It's true. Records are broken. Krishna tells us in the Gita that our real happiness should not be in the results of what we do, but in the quality of the consciousness in which we do it. Krishna tells Arjuna, do not be attached to victory or defeat, success or failure, pleasure or pain, honor and dishonor. Be attached to dharma. And the highest dharma is bhakti. Yat karosi rashnasi yajjo hoshi dadasya. Whatever you do, do it for my pleasure, Krishna says. It is our devotion that pleases Krishna. There's so many examples of this. Duryodhana himself, I'm skipping way ahead from this story. But when the Pandavas and the Kurus, when it was inevitable that there was going to be a war, Duryodhana wanted to get Krishna on his side. And he was so expert. He was really brilliant. Sometimes we just think of Duryodhana as being just a mad, crazy, envious person. He was, but he was also, in order to get his way, he could be the most refined, charitable, intelligent person. And he knew how to win people over. He would treat them with such respect and give them so many gifts that they were obliged to be on his side. So he invited Krishna to his palace. And he had the best dancers and the best cooks and the best interior decorators, and he had the most wonderful gifts, everything just to show Krishna how much he's going so far out of his way to give Krishna happiness. Then Krishna's gonna, when he asks Krishna a favor after he's doing all that, Krishna's gonna be obliged to be on his side. But Krishna doesn't care anything for things. He's concerned with our love and devotion. All the preparations were made. And Krishna knows just how to teach good lessons. He walked right by Duryodhana's house. The whole reception's there waiting. He just walked by, didn't even look. Now that's an insult. And then he went to Vidura's house. Vidura wasn't even expecting him. Kunti Devi was living with Vidura while the Pandavas were in exile. And Vidura didn't have anything prepared for him. And according to the story, they just gave Krishna a banana. And according to how some people tell that story, Vidura and his wife, they were so nervous that Krishna just showed up at their house that they peeled the banana and threw the banana out and gave Krishna the peel. And Krishna ate it. And he was completely satisfied. He was more happy with this little offering of love than all of the things, the crowns and the jewels and the sumptuous food that Duryodhana had prepared for him. Because Krishna sees the intent. The only thing that satisfies the heart is to love and be loved. And any gift, its value is only in the love in which it is given and received. That's the only value to the heart. The material worth of something can give some fleeting attachment to the mind and senses. Can't touch the heart. So Duryodhana and his brothers, they were so envious because everything they wanted. They wanted the affection, they wanted the respect, they wanted the attention of every, in any way, from all the citizens, and they were getting it. And they loved it, and they were attached to it. And here comes the Pandavas, and they didn't even want it. It just came to them anyway, because they were so good. So Duryodhana, even though the Pandavas were their well-wishers, he started making plots to murder them. They're brothers. In those days, cousins were called brothers. So they decided, Shakuni was the brother of Gandhari. And he was a really angry person too. Because Bhishma brought Gandhari and Shakuni wanted her to marry Pandu, but instead she got married to Dhritarashtra. So he was really angry. He was really intelligent, but he used it all in the wrong ways. So Shakuni and Duryodhana were always making these plots of how to destroy the Pandavas. And they're intelligent. Usually, what you are most attached to becomes either a strength or a weakness. That's how Maya works. If Maya sees you have a weakness of a particular type of attachment, she will try to exploit that and use that to destroy you. Hari Hari. Param drishtva nivartate, bhakti is to experience a higher taste so we can actually tolerate and overcome these weaknesses. So Bhima, he was really strong. He didn't have any physical weaknesses at all. But he loved to eat. Srila Prabhupada explains, one name of Bhima is Brikodar. Brikodar means one who can eat like a hungry wolf. He could eat massive sums of food. But the difference between Bhima and us, he can eat so much. But then with the power and strength he gets from that food, he would do supernatural activities. If we try to eat like Bhima, we'll get sick and fall asleep. So Bhima likes to eat a lot. So they took him on an excursion to play on the banks of the Ganga, and they made these delicious cakes and filled them with poison. More poison than what hundreds of people could possibly eat. It would kill hundreds of people, grown men, and Bhima was just a boy. And he ate it all. And he still played all day. And then at the end of the day, he kind of felt sleepy because of the poison. And he laid down, and they thought he was dead, and they threw him in the Ganga. But Krishna's always kunti apurati janihi name bhakta puranashati. Krishna's always there for his devotees. And whatever happens to a devotee, it's always for the good, whether they live or whether they die. Because ultimately there's no death. Sometimes people get confused. How is it that a devotee can die in a way that appears to be before their time? Or how sometimes even suffering? From our perspective, we can calculate in terms of years, in terms of pleasure and pain. But if Krishna wants to protect us, nothing can harm us. And even if something does harm us, if we have taken shelter of Krishna, if we're dear to Krishna, then he will give the soul the highest rewards. Everyone has to die. What is history? History is just all these narrations about people who are now dead. Yes. You live 100 years, maybe. In England, if you get to be 100 years, the Queen personally gives you a gift. Something to live for. It's a good thing, but how long are you going to be able to enjoy that gift? So the Srimad Bhagavatam tells us, better one moment of full consciousness than a long, long life wasted in material consciousness. Some of the greatest people throughout history live very short lives, but they change the whole world by the qualities of their life. So Krishna had a purpose for Bhima. So while he was underwater, these snakes started biting him. Now for most of us, you know, we don't want to get bit by snakes, but these snakes neutralized the poison that was in Bhima. And he was empowered. And he came out of the water more powerful than ever before. So Duryodhana, it was all kept secret what they tried to do. It made them even more determined. And then Duryodhana was telling his father, Dhritarashtra, they must be killed. They have to be killed. Otherwise, they're going to be the kings. What about me? Dhritarashtra said, what about you? Yudhisthira's a good older brother. He said, no, I'll commit suicide if he becomes king. And you'll be responsible. So Dhritarashtra was really, he was in Maya. he was under the influence of his son. And he was attached to his son. And by associating with his son, he was becoming like that. And meanwhile, Bhishma and Vidura, they were watching this whole thing happening and they were brokenhearted by it. Vidura was always giving Dhritarashtra good advice. Vidura was the younger brother. He was the most qualified. But just because of some technicality in his birth,
He was not given certain rights. But he was the most qualified. He was completely the well-wisher of everyone. He had no animosity, no enmity in his heart. He loved Krishna. Krishna was his nephew, kind of. He loved everyone. And he was always giving Dhritarashtra good advice. And Dhritarashtra would hear it. And Dhritarashtra knew that Vidura is my best friend. He's my well-wisher, and everything he says is right. But then he would hear from Duryodhana, and due to his attachment to Duryodhana, he would always go along with him. What a troubled life he had. Even though he was sitting on the throne, he was the king, Dhritarashtra was nothing but miserable. Duryodhana was nothing but miserable. So they made another plot. Varanavata was a beautiful place, and there was a big festival to celebrate Lord Shiva that was coming up. It's like a vacation place. I guess, what is that place? Mahabaleshwaram, where wealthy people from Mumbai like to go there, and they have their homes there to kind of go on holidays. Well, Varanavata was like that. It was a very, very nice place. So let's send the Pandavas there and promise them a nice vacation, and they can celebrate this beautiful festival from Lord Shiva, and everyone will be so happy that they're there. So Dhritarashtra was inviting them there. It was all a plot. And Yudhisthira Maharaj, he was so respectful to his uncle, but in his mind he was thinking, why is Dhritarashtra sending us, but not his own children? And why is he all of a sudden so nice to me? And he's offering us so beautiful vacation, holiday, and all. He says he's going to build a brand new palace just for us to live there, just for a vacation for some time. He was mysteriously nice. So Yudhisthira respectfully understood something's happening. And when they were about, and what happened is Duryodhana and Shukuni, they called a man named Purochana, who was like an architect and a builder. And they told him to build a beautiful palace out of totally flammable materials. But the types of materials, if you put a single little flame, just a tiny little flame, it will immediately go into fire within seconds. So Purochan went to Varanavata, and he started building this palace. And he built it really fast. And every article that was being put in this building was soaked in flammable oils, like lac. It was called the House of Lac. He would soak the bricks in lac. They were just saturated. Then he built the house like that, and he painted over it, and he put lac in the paint too. Whatever type of paint they used in those days, it was probably organic paint. It was definitely organic. They didn't have chemicals in those days. It was organic paint. But the lac was organic too, I guess. But it was very... That house was just built to burn. And then he put all these pots of ghee all over the place to make it look auspicious. And then he got some sort of natural fragrance to cover the, to make it really sweet smelling. And it was built. Meanwhile, as Yudhisthira and the Pandavas with Kunti, as they were leaving Hastinapur to go on their vacation, Dhritarashtra said, please enjoy, and Duryodhana said, oh, you will have so much fun there, it's such a nice place. Vidura spoke in a language that nobody could understand. He spoke a very simple tribal language. But Yudhisthira understood so many languages. But more than that, Yudhisthira could understand people's hearts. And Vidura said some little poetic line that was really confusing to people who heard it. He said something like, beware of weapons that are meant for your destruction, that are not made out of steel or any hard material. What does that mean? And beware of that which can consume even straw and wood, but cannot harm a person who's in a hole in the ground. Something like that. And then he said, one who controls their mind and senses can never be conquered. So Kunti asked Yudhisthira, what does that mean? Yudhisthira later told that Vidura has told us that they're going to try to burn us alive. And Vidura sent some of his messengers to the Pandavas. They lived in Varanavata for some time. Should I continue the story or should I? Okay. And meanwhile, the house was being completed. And they were living. When they arrived at Varanavata, all the people there were cheering and celebrating because everyone loved the Pandavas. And this is what was really embroiling the envy of Duryodhana, that everybody loved them. Wherever Duryodhana would go, people would say, yes, master, yes, master. But wherever Yudhisthira would go is, oh, we'll do anything for you. We'll give everything for you. Duryodhana wanted what Yudhisthira had. He had the love of the people. He wasn't just respected, he was loved. Duryodhana was feared. And by his manipulations, by his incredibly intelligent organization and engineering, he had control, he had the fear of the people, but he couldn't get their love and truth and the respect of their hearts. And that's what greatness is, to actually be loved, not feared. And if we fear somebody with love, that's all right too. But when our love goes beyond fear, that's more high, that's deeper. So, when Yudhisthira was leaving Hastinapur, everyone was saying goodbye with such love, and Duryodhana, just wait till he burns alive. He was so enthusiastic. And when Yudhisthira Maharaj came to Varanavata, all the citizens, every single citizen came and celebrated his arrival. And eventually the house was built. And Yudhisthira Maharaj told the Pandavas what happened. Bhima said, we shouldn't go there. Why are we going to live there? They want to burn us alive. And Yudhisthira Maharaj said, no, we should live there. We will escape. let them think we're dead. He had his plan. And Vidura kept sending him messages and help. And they dug an underground tunnel. And on an Amavasya, a new moon night, that was the time destined for the house to be put on fire. And they got that message. And they escaped from an underground fire. And the house blazed. And everyone thought that Kunti and her sons were dead. And when the news came, Dhritarashtra started crying. And Duryodhana started crying. And everyone was crying. And they were giving all these tributes of honor to the Pandavas, just to make it sound like they were compassionate, well-wishing, loving, and they were grieving. But actually, in their hearts, they were really, really celebrating. They're dead. Now everything is ours. How is that? Such envy. And it's interesting because Duryodhana is the grandson of Vyasadeva, who's the literary incarnation of Bhagavan, Sri Krishna. How could he be in such a state? Duryodhana was being brought up in the presence of Bhishma, Mahajan, Vidura, Paramahamsa. But still, he made these choices. He was so duplicitous. But Vidura could see it all, and Bhishma could see it all. But Vidura was happy that the Pandavas were safe, and they went into hiding for some time. And because time's up, I can't say too much more. But many incredible things happened at that time. They went to Ekachakra. And there they were living incognito. All the Kurus thought that they were dead, but Vidura knew what was going on. He knew they were safe. There was funerals and everything for them. In Ekachakra, the story of Bakasura. Baka was a really powerful person. But Bhima, actually, I won't tell that story. But Baka was such a demon. He demanded on a regular basis that the people of Ekachakra brought him a huge wagon load of food. And as the dessert, he would eat the charioteer who drove it. So he would eat an entire wagon load of food and then eat the driver. And he was like one of these mafia kind of people. Either you give me this or I'm going to terrorize your entire village. So it was like they were paying him off. So rather than every one of the children being subject to be killed by him, they would just send one on intervals with the wagon. So the place where the Pandavas were staying with Kunti, the mother was crying. And Kunti said, "What's happening?" They said, "It's chosen that our son has to drive the wagon to Bakasura. That means he's going to be eaten alive." And Kunti said, "No problem. I'll send my son instead. I have Bhima." And the lady, she said, no, I can't tell you to sacrifice your son for my son. I only have one son." Kunti said, "I have five, no problem." So Kunti convinced her, and Bhima drove the whole chariot. Big, giant, huge amount of food.
And he went, and Bhima was really, really expert. He went right up to where Bakasura was waiting, and right in front of Bakasura, Bhima ate everything.
This really made him angry, and Bakasura attacked Bhima while he was eating.
Bhima was so, he couldn't care less about this Baka. With his right hand, he was eating, and with his left hand, he was just pushing him away until he finished everything. Then after he finished everything, he washed his hands and he finished Baka. Kunti understood her son. And it was in that same Eka Chakra that Lord Nityananda Prabhu, about 4,500 years later, took his birth there, in the place where the Pandavas resided. And soon after that, there was the wonderful pastime where Draupadi chose Arjuna to be her husband at a Swayamvara. And Arjuna came back and told Kunti Devi, I brought a wonderful gift. And Kunti Devi said, whatever valuable thing you have, you must always share with your brothers. Arjuna said, it's a wife. Kunti, whatever she said couldn't go in vain. So under these extraordinary circumstances, Draupadi married all the five Pandavas. And there was no envy among them, because they loved each other so much, and they loved her so much, and she loved them so much. And Kunti was, even though they were in exile, they were under persecution, they were being dishonored, they were being blasphemed, for the Pandavas it was painful, especially when it's your own family doing this to you, in your own house. It's one thing when enemies from an outside camp are attacking you, but when your own family, your own purpose, very painful. And of everyone, Kunti suffered the most. And later on in this great tournament, when Arjuna was winning everything, Dronacharya had this special tournament, like the graduation ceremony of all the from his school, and there were the Kurus and the Pandavas. And Arjuna was just mesmerizing everyone with his skills. And suddenly, an unknown person enters the arena. And he excels Arjuna in everything. Who is this person? Nobody knew who he was, except Kunti. She saw the earrings and the chest plate of gold that he had. She understood this was her firstborn son, Karna. And instantly he became worst enemies with Arjuna. And instantly Duryodhana saw that here is somebody more powerful than my rival, and he won over Karna and started giving him gifts and made him the king of a province. Everything Karna could possibly want, Duryodhana was giving him. He lavished him so much that Karna was totally obliged to him. And Kunti couldn't tell anyone. But as soon as she saw him, she fainted. And Vidura immediately understood this must be her son. He was so intelligent. So after the Pandavas and Kunti Devi returned to Hastinapur, the word got out that they were actually still alive. The Kurus, headed by Duryodhana, Dhritarashtra, they grieved when they were performing the last rites, the funeral for the Pandavas. At least they pretended to, although in their hearts they were jubilant. But when the Pandavas came back, externally they were celebrating. The Pandavas are still alive. Look, they're still alive. But in their hearts they were grieving. They were immediately thinking of other methods to destroy them. But when they returned, Krishna. Krishna, who was in Dwarka, heard about the Pandavas' return, and he came there to meet them. And in this particular verse we're reading today, Satyaki comes with Krishna. He's a very senior elder person, and the Pandavas are receiving them with such honor and respect. And how Krishna is reciprocating with each person according to their particular relationship with him. Because Krishna is the supreme personality of Godhead. And higher than the infinite peace of Brahman realization is the infinite intimacy of love, of prema. Krishna's conquered by the love of his devotees. Yudhisthira is older than Krishna. And so is Bhima. So Krishna is bowing down to Yudhisthira and touching his feet. And Yudhisthira Maharaj, even though he knows Krishna's his beloved Lord, the cause of all causes, the absolute truth, the controller of all controllers, the king of kings, the father of Brahma, the source of Mahavishnu. Yudhisthira knows this. But Krishna wants to exchange love with him in this way. So Yudhisthira Maharaj is blessing Krishna. And Krishna's touching his feet. But it's all with such intimate love. And then Arjuna, who's Krishna's same age, out of etiquette, they're embracing as friends. And Nakula and Sahadev, they're younger, they're touching Krishna's feet. And Krishna's blessing them. And Krishna's bowing down to Vidura and the elders, and they're blessing him. In this way, there's this intimate exchange of love that Krishna's facilitating according to a particular person's relationship with him. And as Krishna's sitting on a beautiful seat, he sees Queen Kunti coming. Ishvara sarvabhutanam hridesher janatishtati. The Lord is within the heart of everyone. He knows our every thought. He knows our every feeling intimately. He hears our every word. He sees our every action. So Krishna knows Kunti's heart, what she has been going through. Krishna's his aunt. Krishna touches her feet, and Kunti embraces him as her own nephew. And Kunti's asking Krishna about all the people of the Yadu dynasty in Dwarka. This is Kunti's nature. What she's going through. But she's so concerned with Krishna and so concerned with others. and it is described in this beautiful verse today. The Lord then went to see his aunt, Queen Kunti. He bowed down to her, and she embraced him, her eyes moist with great affection. Lord Krishna inquired from her and her daughter-in-law, Draupadi, about their welfare, and they in turn questioned him at length about his relatives in Dwarka. Kunti worshipped Krishna, and Krishna worshipped Kunti. Krishna knows past, present, and future. In the second canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, we read the prayers of Queen Kunti. And we will end our class today with a reflection on her state of consciousness. It is said, Srila Prabhupada explained, a proverb from Bengal, that the mother-in-law will teach the daughter-in-law through instructing the daughter. Does that make sense to you? Because the daughter-in-law is kind of strange in the house, because in India, traditionally, there are joint families. So the mother-in-law doesn't want to disturb the daughter-in-law, because the daughter-in-law doesn't know how to do anything in that house. So if she's just correcting her, the daughter-in-law is going to feel really depressed and like she's doing everything wrong. And a loving mother-in-law will never do that to the daughter-in-law. I'm instructing you mother-in-laws at this point. There's sensitivity, there's affection. So the mother-in-law will affectionately instruct the daughter. And the daughter, she's used to living in the house, no problem. She knows my mother loves me. By instructing the daughter-in-law learns everything without hurting her, without making her feel inferior. This is it's a science of respect and affection within a household. So in the same way, Krishna teaches the world through his loving devotees. And Kunti was his loving devotee. Krishna would touch her feet and bow down to her. Yet Kunti went through so many tragedies in her life. Her motherly heart. What happened to Karna? What happened to her children? What happened to her beloved daughter-in-law Draupadi when she was being stripped by Dushasana? All these situations Kunti had to bear and tolerate. But in the end, she prayed to Krishna. Vipada shandu tashashva tatra tatra jagat guru. Let these calamities come again and again. Because when they come, I remember you. I have no one else to turn to except you. And in remembering you, I am beyond birth and death. Tate nukampam susumikshamano bunjana evatma kritam vibhagam. Lord Brahma offered this prayer to Krishna. That when to that devotee who even in the most difficult, trying situations turns to you with a humble and grateful heart, that person alone is fit for the highest liberation. It's not a matter of how little we can eat or how little we can sleep, although we shouldn't waste our time eating too much or sleeping too much. The reason we don't eat a lot or sleep a lot is not because we want to show everybody how renounced we are. It's because we want to extend our gratitude to Krishna by utilizing every moment of our time in serving him and remembering him and loving him. It's for that purpose. Brahmacharis living in the ashram, they don't renounce the opportunity for families and everything and property so that people will see that they're great ascetics. They come here so that they can utilize their full energy and their full minds in loving devotional service. Grihasthas, they don't give in great charity to help elevate people's consciousness so that they will be honored and esteemed. They're doing it because they understand everything they have belongs to God. Let me use it for that purpose. This is bhakti. But if in the end, whatever spiritual activities we do, what actually makes us fit for the highest liberation is through our association, through our sadhana, through our seva, we come to the state of consciousness where even when great challenges and setbacks come in our lives, and they will, whoever we are, we can turn to God with gratitude and give our hearts to Him. That was Kunti Devi's example. And that is why Krishna is touching her feet. Not just because of the formality that she's his aunt, but Krishna wants to show the world how he worships those devotees who always remember him in love in any situation. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught us, Kunti herself, she prayed to Krishna in her prayers, Janmaishwaraya Shruta Shibir, that a person who is too much attached to wealth, high birth, physical beauty, or very high education cannot feelingly call out your holy name because they become proud. Akinchana Gotra. That means even if you have high wealth, even if you have high birth, wealth, education, and all of this, if we understand nothing is mine, then we could call out Krishna's names with feelings. So God has appeared within his name. Nam nama karipa nija sarva shaktis. Krishna has appeared in his name. And he has many names. And within these divine names, he has invested all of his powers, all of his potencies. Trinadapi sunichena. If we have a humble heart and we call out these names in any situation with gratitude, Krishna will reciprocate and give us himself. Krishna is showing us here, he worships the devotee who worships him with such a humble and grateful heart. Lord Chaitanya, Lord Nityananda, they gave great scholars and simple, uneducated people the holy names of the Lord. It didn't matter, whoever they were. And if they saw that they were chanting with humble hearts, Lord Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda would touch their feet, embrace them, give them garlands, and say, I am your property. In this spirit, Srimad Bhagavatam is teaching us to chant the holy name. Introduce two very dear friends who have come from long distance of Woodstock, New York. They are two of the most empowered yoga teachers in the world. And they have founded a yoga studio which has teachers and branches all over the world, and they're wonderful devotees and beautiful people who really try to give something with very deep substance. They're very powerful animal rights activists and human rights activists also. Sometimes people are animal rights activists, but they're not nice to people, to human people. But if we actually understand animals are people and humans are also people, then we actually extend, as God's great instruments of God's grace, compassion to all. And this is the very heart of their mission, is to teach these values of devotion along with very incredible system of yoga as well. And they were very dear friends of our dear brother Shamdasji, who you remember stayed with us a few years ago at Radha Gopinath temple. They regularly would visit him at Govardhan and Vrindavan and Gokul and Natwar. And at this time, about 80 students are at Govardhan Eco Village for a teacher's training. They're there for 1 month. And Padma Devi and David Life are the leaders of this wonderful Jiva Mukti Society, and very, very dear friends. And it was always a dream of mine that they would be here with us in Mumbai. And I'm so grateful that both of you are here. Please be part of our family here forever. And everyone who would like them to be a part of our family forever, very lovingly and loudly chant Hari Bol. Million times louder, please. Is there any questions? As sure as the sun rises every morning and the sun sets every evening, Ananda Vrindavan will always have a question after.
Maharaj, talking about the Pandavas, we know that they are pure devotees and they have gone through so many difficulties and hardship in their life. But when the difficulties came to Yudhishthir Maharaj, a stage came in Yudhishthir Maharaj's life also where Yudhishthir Maharaj complained to Krishna that, Krishna, why you are putting so much difficulties on us? Yashaha mani grihnani, he spoke that thing. So that thing, we being a conditioned soul, we take shelter of that thing in our life. That when Yudhishthir Maharaj also complains to Krishna, when difficulty comes in our life, it's very natural that we will also complain to Krishna. And in that circumstances, our commitment and our dedication goes down in Krishna consciousness, because we are taking shelter of that thing. So what to do when difficulties come in our life? We don't take that shelter and we just take it as Krishna's mercy and don't do as a complaint, but take as a Krishna's mercy and go ahead. Because that is always that we take shelter of that thing and we go away from giving 100% commitment to Krishna consciousness and taking a shelter of that thing in our life.
Thank you. That's a problem when we take one little piece but we don't see the whole picture. So we want to do what Yudhishthir did as far as asking a serious question to our Krishna, which sounds like complaining, but what about the rest of it? He asked Krishna, why is all this happening? And Krishna said, yasyaham anagrinami harishyetatanam shanai. The Yudhishthir Maharaj, when I show my favor to my devotee, I give whatever he wants. But when I give my complete favor, I take away everything. So that devotee has nowhere else to turn to except me. Now, what does that mean? Take away everything. It doesn't. It may mean that Krishna takes away everything materially, or it may mean he doesn't take away anything materially. Eventually, time does. Krishna says, time I am. But what Krishna is explaining is, when there is impediments in the heart of my devotee, I'm actually offering myself. And as long as we're dependent on material conditions, we never really take shelter of Krishna. Just like if you're in an airplane and all of a sudden there's alarms. I've been in airplanes like this where they say, we're about to crash. Emergency landing. Yes? What are you going to do? You're in an airplane. The engines and the control system of the airplane breaks down. And you're about 30,000 feet above sea level. It's not that you can call your fire department or your police department or your life coach teacher. The plane's going down. It's nothing. You're totally helpless. Yes? In such a state, what do you do? The first thing you may do is say, Krishna, why are you doing this to me? That's natural. That's what Yudhishthir did. Why are you doing this to me? But then you realize, if Krishna's doing it to me, that means Krishna must be there for me. And then with all your heart, all your life, all your soul, you just give your body, mind, heart, and soul to Krishna in that state. And you cry. It's not that you're chanting like falling asleep. Because usually in airplanes, everyone's falling asleep. Yes? It's not like in that state, you actually take shelter. And if the plane crashes, you attain the life's perfection and you go back to Krishna's eternal abode. So that's journey home in the fast lane. Huh? And if the plane somehow or other lands safely, you'll never forget it. You will definitely think for the rest of your life that was the most spiritual I've ever been in an airplane. It's the best flight of my life. I never want it to happen again, but it was the best flight. Never felt so close to God. Yes? So Yudhisthira took shelter. So he's asking the question to be like us, but then he's also responding to show us what we're supposed to do. So it's not a problem when we say, God, what are you? Why are you doing this? Even Jesus, when he was on the cross, he cried, why have you forsaken me, my Father? But that was in the ecstasy of separation. It wasn't in bewilderment. And similarly, Yudhisthira Maharaj had complete faith in Krishna. It was just his human nature speaking that. But the lesson he's giving us is how he spoke it and how he lived when he received Krishna's message. Similarly with Arjuna, in the battle of Kurukshetra, Arjuna was bewildered. He was instructing Krishna. Krishna, I'm not going to fight. And he was giving all the reasons. And then he became so completely overcome by the circumstance that he started to cry. He dropped his bow, Gandiba, and said, Karpanya doso bahata swabhava. Krishna, I don't know anything. Please instruct me. So Arjuna's playing the role of us. And in certain cases, Duryodhana's playing the role of us. The dark parts within our own life of envy and everything, we can see them, we can picture what they are in Duryodhana. And when we read about Duryodhana, we're disgusted with him. Yes? And in the same way, we see what the end result is. And those same qualities within us, we can see that Duryodhana propensity, and therefore we don't trust them, we don't give in to them. We take shelter of our Yudhisthira propensities. Does that answer your question?
But sometimes that phase is a little bit more extended. And that extension phase is making our spiritual life more disturbing and not getting that full commitment to give shelter of Krishna. So when that phase which is going, getting too much prolonged, we have a fear that we might lose that attachment to Krishna. And we might lose this charm of Krishna consciousness. So what to do that phase should not be so big enough in our life. We get it and we immediately take it as shelter of Krishna. That is not coming up.
It's not such a long time. What is a lifetime, 2 lifetimes, 10 lifetimes? The soul is eternal. But at the same time, what is important is we know what we want to do. We want to take shelter. And if it's taking more time, which it usually does, it's the way the world works, it means that we need that much purification. And we're aware of that. It humbles us. It's like a little child. Parents gives the child medicine, which is good for them, but the children don't like it. And if the parent gives you medicine for, due to a disease for several weeks. When will it be ended? When will it be ended? But the important thing is you take the medicine. Satsang, sadhana, seva, that's the medicine. It really doesn't matter how long. If we have faith, which comes by hearing in the association of people with faith, then we will continue to take that medicine. We will continue to take shelter, however long it takes. That is our sincerity. Krishna knows just what we need. Hare Krishna. Thank you very much.